So the focus is that first we will go through with the brief introduction of the what is API and how it works. Then we will directly jump into the Postman tool and we will demonstrate how it works. This is a demo class. So we are not going to cover all the like options of Postman, but the basic things will be covered in this tutorial. So, and for further if you want to further know about how Postman works and all the details, you will join our live classes. There we can teach you how to do how to use Postman with the other options. So let's get started without wasting the time. So I'm sharing the next slide. So today's agenda is that we will see the following topics in this particular session. So first we will see what is an API, what is API testing. Then we will see API, why API testing, then types of API testing, then what is REST API and API testing, the difference between the REST API and SOAP API, what to test in API testing, why you should perform API testing, test cases for API testing, HTTP fundamentals, and then HTTP methods, HTTP status codes, then what is Postman, installation of Postman, API testing using Postman demo. Finally, we can see. So now we can start with the what is API. So all of you must be aware of that, like API stands for Application Programming Interface. This is basically a collection of the function of procedure, which allows us to communicate between two different types of application. As you can see in the figure, the API is in the center and all the other different applications will interact with the API. So API act as an intermediate between the two different devices or two different applications to communicate or to transfer data between those applications. So I hope it is clear to you what is API. Then what is API testing? What is API testing? API testing is a software testing. It is a type of software testing that validates application programming interface. Application programming interface is nothing but a function or the procedure of the call, as we already discussed in the previous slide. The purpose of the API testing is to check the functionality, the reliability, performance, and the security of the programming interface. So the main purpose is that we have to check the functionality, the reliability, performance, and the security. In API testing, instead of using the standard user input keyboards and the UI, we are just sending the API calls to the server and get the output from the server. So API testing are very different from the GUI testing, and one concentrate on the looks and feel, because in UI testing, we generally concentrate on the like look and feel things, all these the text and the drop downs and all these things we are concentrating. But here we are mainly concentrating on the business logic layers of the software architecture. Hope you will understand why API testing we need. Then why should we do the API testing? In the previous slide, we said what is API testing and why we need an API testing. So what is the need of API testing? So in today's software development, there are separate layers in a typical application, like the presentation layer, or you can say the user interface layer, in the middle, the business layer, and the database layer, at the backend for monitoring and manipulating the data. So what API does, API testing is performed at the most critical layer, that is the business layer, in which business logic processing is carried out and all the transaction between the user interface and the database layer happens. As you can see in the figure, the first one is GUI testing works here in the presentation layer. Business layer, we do the API testing, and at the backend is the database layer. So we are testing the middle layer, that is the business layer, which interacts with the both the database layer and the presentation layer. So that is why the API testing. Now we are moving to next slide. Types of API testing. There are normally four basic types of API, four different types of APIs, like public APIs, partner API, private and composite APIs. In this context, the API type indicates the intent scope of use, like public API, anyone can use it, partner API, some two parties can use it, private APIs, suppose your organization can use it, the private APIs, and the composite API means the combination of both the private and the public APIs. So we are here, we are only concerned about the web APIs. There are different types of APIs, but we are using the web APIs, the API that works on the web. So basically, there are three types of web APIs. First one is the simple object access protocol, that is the SOAP, which uses the XML language. Then comes to the remote procedure call. Then the final is representational state transfer, that is the REST. So in this class, we are focusing on the representational state transfer, that is the REST protocol. So you can see all these are web APIs, SOAP, RPC, and the REST. What is REST API in API testing? So what is REST? So as REST is an acronym for representational state transfer, that is stateless in key, an API can be a REST if it is following the below constraints. Any API is basically REST is a design pattern. REST is not a protocol, REST is a design pattern. Any API which follows the below six constraints can become a REST API. The REST architectural style describes six constraints. Here you can see it describes the six constraints. These constraints put on the architecture where initially communicated by Roy Fielding in the doctor description and defines the basic RESTful style. These are the basic RESTful style. Any API which follows these six constraints can become a REST API. So REST is basically is not a protocol, REST is a design pattern. There is a difference between the REST and the SOAP. We will discuss it later slides. So first one is uniform interface. That means an API can communicate without any constant restricting itself to a particular interface. Second is the stateless. The stateless means it does not maintain any state, or it does not maintain any caches, or the you can see cookies, cacheless. But that is the server does not maintain any data for the client. It is a client server architecture, basically. It is a layered system. Different layer has been made. Code on demand. So all these constraints can become a REST API. Any API which follows these six constraints can become a REST API. Now we will see what's the difference between the REST API versus the SOAP API. SOAP stands for Simple Object Access Protocol. as you can see, SOAP is an XML-based messaging protocol, whereas the REST is an architectural style protocol. SOAP uses web WSDL for communication between consumer and provider. Whereas REST uses XML or JSON to send and receive data. Then SOAP invokes services by calling a remote procedure call method, whereas REST uses simple calls services via URL path. Do not read human readable results. When the result is written by the server, when we are using the SOAP UI, it is not easily readable by the humans. Whereas in case of REST, result is readable, which is just a plain XML or JSON. Okay. So then transfer is over HTTP. Also uses other protocols such as SMTP, Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, FTP, File Transfer Protocol, and or any other protocol. Whereas the transfer is only happens in case of REST, HTTP protocol. It uses only HTTP protocol to transfer data between the client and the server. Whereas in SOAP, JavaScript can call SOAP, but it is difficult to implement. Whereas in case of REST, it is easy to call the JavaScript. Performance is not great as compared to the REST, whereas in the REST API, performance is much better as compared to the SOAP, as it consumes less CPU resources. So hope you understand the difference between the API, REST API and the SOAP APIs. Then what to test in API testing? What are the things we are going to test in the API testing? So in API testing, what we validate the keys with minimum and maximum range of APIs. That is the maximum and the minimum range of APIs. This is the first thing we are going to verify. Then have to test cases to do XML, JSON schema validation. We will validate the schemas. Then key verification. If we have JSON XML API, we would verify if that all the keys are coming or not. That is means key or value pair, we will verify the key or value pair in this API testing. Verify how API error code handled. Means whenever we send a request to the server will send appropriate API, appropriate HTTP status code. So we have to verify whether the server is sending the correct API code or not, or the code is not able to handle the request. So these things we have to verify in the API testing. So now we move into the next slide. Why you should perform API testing? Many of the services that we use every day rely on hundreds of different of interconnected APIs. That is, we are talking about the microservices. Microservices is like different types of small functions that interact with the application. This is called microservices architecture. If any of them fails, then the service will not work. Right now, internet uses millions of APIs and they should need to be tested thoroughly. Developers might make mistakes and they create buggy APIs. So it's our duty to test the API. Validation of API is very important, which are going to live to production. Before going to the production, the validation of API is a necessary thing. Now, what are the different types of test cases of API? The test cases for the API is what we check: return value based on the input conditions. Whatever the input conditions we have sent to the server, we will get the right status code. do not return anything, we will have to check if we are sending the correct request to the server, whether we are getting the correct status code or not. Trigger some other API events, interrupted, update data structure. We will update the records by using the API HTTP methods and modify certain resources. So these are the basic test cases which we are going to validate while testing any of the APIs. These are the basic things. Based on that, we can write the test cases as per the requirement or the business system or the software specification document. So now we are moving to some like HTTP fundamentals. What is HTTP? HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. HTTP is an application layer protocol designed within the framework of the Internet Protocol Suites. This is client which performs a request resource, which can be HTML page, file extra from server, and server performs the response to the client back using the same protocol known as HTTP. HTTP is a stateless protocol. That is, it does not maintain any state. In other words, the current request does not know what has been done in the previous request. So you can see in this picture, so you can look into the below figure. Here the HTTP protocol basics. Here a client, a user, sends a request to the server, and server get back the response to the client. This is the basic thing about HTTP. Client sends a request to the server, and server validates the request, and then it sends back the response. Here you can see in the another picture, like HTTP, your computer, like HTTP client, it sends the request to the HTTP server. It is HTTP request, and then the server sends back the HTTP reply. So this is the basic thing about HTTP protocol, because the REST API works on the HTTP protocol. Now we see some of the methods of HTTP. Here, the following methods which we are going to perform by using the postman. And here is the description. First, the get method. What get method does? Get method requests to read a web page. Means it reads the web page or it fetches the data from the server. Head request to read the web page. Header. What is put method? Put method requests to store a web page. What is the post method? Append a name, or we can add anything, any data to the API. Delete method removes the web page or removes the data. Trace, echo the incoming request. Connect method reserves the future use, and optional query setup options. So this is the description, and here in this particular table you can see the HTTP methods, whether these are the name of the HTTP methods, and request has body, whether these methods will require the body or not, response code. Whether we are getting the response code from the server by using these methods or not, it is safe or not, it is independent or not, it is cacheable or not. So you can see the get method, request body is not needed, response code we are getting, it is a safe, it is important, indie important, and cacheable. Post method requires the body. Post method has body, yes. Response has body, yes. It is safe, no. Important, no. And the cacheable, yes. So you can see these are the different HTTP methods, and these are the whether it requires the request body, whether it gets the response from the server, whether it is a safe or not, whether it is a cacheable or not. So this is a particular overall table. Now these are the HTTP response status code. You can see these are the response codes. So H1XXX, it is informational, 100 means continue, 10 means switching protocol, 102 processing, 2XXX means success, 200 means if we are sending a request to a server and we are getting a response, that is it sends the response with status code 200, okay. Then 201, it is used when we create or post some request. Then 202. Likewise, you can see the 3x redirectional means it redirects the web page. Whenever we send some request, its server will get back with these error codes. 4XXX client error means if we are sending any bad request, server will return 400 bad request. If we are sending a request which we are not authorized, then server will return unauthorized 401. So these types of status code, the server will return if the client sends any request which is not valid or having some problem. Then come to 5XXX. These error comes from the server side. Suppose client sends a correct request, but the resource is not available at the server. Then the server sends the 500 internal server error. Then you can see not implemented. So some of the methods which we can send, like put method, but the put method is not implemented in the server side. It is sent not implemented. Then 502, bad gateway. Then 503, service unavailable. Suppose sometimes the service is down, you will get the response from the service. From the server or in the web page, 503 service not available. 504 gateway timeout. Suppose it sends the request to the server and server will take a lot of time to get back the response, then we will get the gateway timeout error. So these are the different types of status code, HTTP response status code. Now we are going to see what is Postman, because this is the tool we are using to test our APIs. So Postman is basically a tool. It is an API testing tool developed and tested developers and testers to perform API testing with lots of different features like global variables, mock requests, environment and monitoring of API. It is a UI tool for the API testing. It is good for exploratory testing, functional and automation testing. It is easy to use, support response parsing like XML and JSON. It supports both XML and JSON. Define the concept of collection for a group of requests. Means you can create a collection of requests in the Postman. Now we will take a pause, then we will start the installation of the Postman. I'm pausing this video for a while. So now we are going to install the Postman. So this is the official website from where we are going to download the postman.com. Although we have two options, either we can download the desktop version of the Postman or we can use directly on the web. So just move on to the web browser. Just type download Postman. Here is the first link, getting started for free. Click on it. Let me okay. So here you can see the Postman app. Download the app. This is for the Windows. Similarly, you can download it for the Mac as well. Not your OS, download the Mac. For Mac, you have to click on this link, and for Linux, you have to click on this link. So download on this particular app. So click on it, as I have already downloaded, so I'm not going to download it. So I will show you how to install. Just click on it and choose the your app based on your operating system, like it is your 32-bit or the 64-bit. Most of these nowadays, most of these laptops or desktops comes with the 64-bit. So generally, you have to download the 64-bit version. So as I have already downloaded it, I will show you. You may download. Here is the Postman setup. Just double click on it. Now it is installed. As you can see how it is easy to install Postman. Okay, so now it's asking for the update or dismiss. Right now I'm dismissing this, don't want any update, so you can dismiss it. So now as I have already downloaded it and installed it in my system, so you can see first you have installed, so you will find this type of interface. Like I have already signed in into this Postman. You can create your own account to sign in, or either you can use your Google account to sign in into the Postman. Because if you are signing into the Postman, it will start syncing your like API test cases, API calls, and all these things, so that you can switch whenever you can switch to the multiple computers or the laptops. So there you can find all your test cases and the test systems which are available. Like earlier I have created some of the test cases which you have seen here. So all these are created. So it is like cloud syncing. As you can see, whenever I click on this, as you can see, in sync, all my data are synced on the cloud. So from here you can update the version of the Postman. So you can see there are following options are available, like home. This is the home. Workspace, we are going to actually working, testing the APIs. The report section. This is the API report section. Some of the versions are, some of the features are paid. But most of the features are freely available with the Postman. So now, this is the explore button. So this is the home. And we are on the workspace. Here in the workspace, you can see the different types of options like collections, apps, environment, mock. You can create your mock servers, monitors, history. Whatever you have tested, all these things will be displayed in the history. Like these things, I have already tested the APIs, the different APIs. So these requests are coming in the history section. So you can collect your create your own collection. Collection is nothing, just a container where you can put all your requests in that container. So it's so before that we have to get some APIs, so publicly available free API. So you can search it on the web, like for the free API. Like these are the free API. You can simply search Simple Book free API. These are the free APIs. free API. These are the endpoints which we are using to test. Another one is Rescue REST. So these are the free APIs. So for this particular session, we are going to use the SimpleBook API. So now we are going to create a collection. Click on the plus button. Name it whatever name you want to give, like my first API test. Okay, you can see it's appear here. Now you can click on it. Now we are going to see there are various types of options available here, like authorization. Means there are multiple types of authorization which is needed. Sometimes whenever you log in into the Facebook or Amazon.com, it will require some authorization key or your login ID or password. So before authenticating whether it is a authentic user or authorized user or not, so these are the different types of authentication things. So we are not going to cover this in this particular class. We will see it in the later classes. So these are the pre-request scripts section where you can create the pre-request scripts, which means the script which is needed before we run the tests. And here we can write the test scripts. And these are the variable sections where we can provide some value. So now we are going to create one GET request. First, we will see this SimpleBook API. So here you can see the API is available at HTTPS. S means secured. Hypertext Transfer Protocol. S stands for secure. SimpleBook API glitch.me. So this is the base URL. Okay, this is the base URL, and the rest of the endpoints are here. How to get the status, how to get the books, how to get a single book. So these are the different endpoints. So there are three parts in this URL. This is the protocol HTTPS. This is the base URL, and this is the endpoint which we are targeting. So now we are creating a GET request. Click on it. Name the request. Save it first. Get the status of API, and we can choose any of the collections. These two collections I've already created, and my first API collections. I'm going to save this. You click on. If you want to add any descriptions, or you can add these descriptions, this API, this request is used for getting the API status. So now we are going to save it. Yes, you can see here. Whenever you can see the cursor, get the status of API. So this is the, here there are different HTTP methods. Get, post, put, patch, delete, which I already discussed in the slides. So now we are enter the URL here. So what's the URL? So URL is this URL. I have to copy and paste it here. And I want to test the status. So I will copy get status. Make it slash here. As this is the get request, we don't want any body for this particular request. Just save it. So these are the different query parameters. Authorization headers, you can see some of the headers are already displayed here automatically. These are coming. Body, which are not required. Pretest conditions are not required. We are just testing whether this API is working or not. So this is here. Yeah. So now if I send this particular request, you can see the status code is 200 okay, and the status is okay. This status is in the form of JSON, Java Object Notation, JavaScript Object Notation. Okay, so we have to verify this status. Like this status means that the server is correctly responding whenever we check the API is working or not. So it returns the 200 okay, and the status is okay here. So you can save the response from here, like to a file. You can also save it to a file, or you can save an as an example. So this is our first request. Now we will see we will get the total number of books available. How to get the total number of books available by using the get function, get method. So we can just duplicate it. As you can duplicate it, now change the name, get the books. Now we again go to the API documentation. Here you can see if we want the list of the book, the end point is books. The base URL remain the same, but the end point is changed. Now we copy this and just replace it with books, single books. Okay, and save it. Here you can see this is saved. And as this is the get method, we do not require any body, nothing else. So you can send the request. You can see in the response section, it will send the book ID, name, type, and available. These are the lists. Like there are six books are available. 1, 2, ID 3, 4. These are the different IDs are available. So this is the whole list of the book. Now, if we are going to fetch a particular book, suppose I want to see the friction, type friction. So what we will do? We will just duplicate it, get request. Just rename it. Single book. Okay. And now we are going to see the API documentation. this is the endpoint we are going to hit for a single. So just copy it. I'll just replace it. And we have to save. So whenever we fired, this is the server is throwing the error. Why is this throwing the error? Because we have not specified any book ID. 404 not found. No book with the ID. Because we are not specifying the ID of the book. So either we can specify the ID here. This is the ID. So if we are specifying ID value is 1. As you can see, now save it. This is the query parameter. As you can see here, the ID is equal to 1. We are querying the parameter. We are parsing the value. Now we can send it. Now it is showing again 404 not found. That means this ID does not exist. Now we go. And book ID 2. Now you can see here what we need. This is the path variable. In this path variable, we are passing the book ID. This is the book ID. This is the book ID. So we are passing the book ID, and the value of the book ID is 2. So it is giving me the only one record with the detailed information. Like ID of the book is 2, name of the book is this, author this, type this, friction, non-friction, all these things. Suppose if we are want to see the friction and non-friction books. So again, I create a duplicate, get status. And now we are applying the single book query. Okay, so you can see now we are type of the book. If we are copying this and we are type. Suppose I type like anything like foo, then see what will it returns. It will send not found. 404 not found, because this particular type is does not exist in the server, in the API. So now we type a particular friction or non-friction. Sorry, we have to specify here. Non-friction. Check why this is not. Sometimes it, this is a public API, sometimes might server is not responding. Book. This is the book ID 1, it will return the book ID 1. Type. Okay, you can see the, if I change the book ID 1, it will show me the book ID 1, all the information of the book ID 1. Then if I change the book ID 3, it will show the book ID 3, all the information. So this is like, you can change all these things like name, author, type and price. You will get all the information pertaining to the availability of the records in the API or in the database. So now you can save all these things. Now we are going to see, all these are get request. Now we are going to see one put request. Put request means ordering a request. Order a book. But before that, we have to authorize this. If we are not authorizing, whenever I send this particular like post method, here is the post method. In point, like this is the authentication. First, we have to register the client with the API, then only you can order the books. So I have already registered the API client with the API client with the API. So we are now, I am now authorized to order the books. So as you can see here in the post book, we have to first pass the client name of the client and the email address. The name of the client can be anything. and the valid email address. So this will generate a token, that is token authorization token. So it will generate a token. You can see this is the token I have put here. This is the token. So once I generated the token, then only I can order the books. So here you can see one more thing. This is the base URL. I have just put two curly braces and read the base URL. As you can see, the information, simply the same information is here. Like whenever you hover over it, like simple book API glitch dot me. So there are two ways. Either you can directly put the URL or you can just put two curly braces before the URL and you will get this type of base URL. Okay, this is the endpoint. So whenever I hit the endpoint, it will show one order is created and this is the order ID. Or this is the order ID. So if I want to see this order ID exists or not, get the order. So just get the order. Order ID. Check the individual order. Here we can copy the order ID and check the orders. This one, save it, post request, and then we can check whether this order exists or not. So you can see this order is exists, as you can see. Here you can see this order is exists. Similarly, we can delete the order, we can like update the order. All the things we are going to see in the later classes in the very detailed manner. So this is a demo class to show you how the Postman works. There are different things you can export and import your request. So here you can find you can import your request. Like if you have already exported your request, you can upload it. All these requests will be here. And similarly, if you want to export your collection, just click on it, and then export. You can export it, and suppose I can export it and then import it. I will show you how it works. Like this is our API. Now I'm going to export it. Export. I'm going to save it on my desktop. My first API. Like suppose I will change the name. Now it is exported. Now I have to import it. Now go to the files, import, file, upload file. My first. Import as a copy because this file already exists. You can see my first collection is here, my new collection. Another one, import, go to the desktop, my first collection /1. Import, we can make a copy You can make as many as copy of these APIs. So I think I have covered all the basic things about the Postman in this particular session. For more details and in-depth testing through API, you can join our live classes where I can taught you the real-time API testing by you using some public URLs. So there are different options I will taught you, like different GET methods and the tricks and the how you can quickly work on the tokens and the variables and the test scripts, how you can automate the Postmans. So I would like to request you to join our live class, and there we will see the Postman more in depth and the advanced things there. So thank you for your patience and time. Hope we will see, we will meet in the live classes. Thank you all, and now I'm leaving the class.